Yes. Okay. So, there's a few different ways that you can kind of decide if a species is threatened or not. But the principal method that is used globally is the IUCN's Red List listing. So the IUCN is the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, and they're a really big global organization, and they cover lots of different aspects of species and ecosystem conservation. But one of their biggest outputs is the Red List. And that's basically a collection of assessments of different species to see how much risk there is to that species, whether it's likely to become extinct anytime in the near future. And there's different ways that they can assess them. So they're generally looking at what's the distribution of the species. Does it just live in a really tiny area that's threatened by human activity, or has their population decreased rapidly over a short space of time? Are there just very few of those individuals? And then there are various criteria that they use to assess the threat to those individual species. Sometimes it's only to a subset of the species, so it might just be a population living in a certain area is more at risk of extinction than in another area. So, you know, it's sometimes a bit more complex, but basically they use a range of criteria to decide if they think there's a great risk to extinction of a particular species. And usually what they do is they try and reassess species every 4 or 5 years just to make sure they're keeping up with any developments for that species. So if you hear the term something's critically endangered or near threatened or those kind of terminologies, then those are linked to the Red List, and they'll give you some rough idea of how at risk a species is. Well, there are a few problems with the Red Listing system. One of the biggest problems is that actually for a lot of species we don't know anything, or we certainly don't know enough to make a clear assessment of that species. So although there may be thousands and thousands of species for which we can say something, there are a huge number of other species that we really just don't know. We don't have enough information. So for some species they'll be classified as data deficient. Just means that we don't know enough about them to make an assessment. The other problem, which is not so much of an issue now, but it used to be very focused on charismatic species, so the big species that we're all familiar with, the big herbivores, you know, the African mammals, the things that really capture the imagination of the public. And although that's not a bad thing, it has been at the detriment of other species that maybe we don't see or we're not familiar with, whether it's amphibians or reptiles or insects. So there is an effort now to try and redress that balance, but there's still an over-dependence on looking at these big, fluffy, charismatic animals. But as I say, that is changing. So that's the IUCN's Red List strategy. There's another way that people have also started to look at things. So rather than just looking at whether there are small numbers or they're reducing in range, they're also thinking about how unique a species is. So in terms of evolution, you know, species have gone down their own sort of path to get to where they are now. And for some species, they don't have any close relatives anymore. So for us as humans, we have very close relatives in chimpanzees, bonobos, and then the great apes, the gorillas. And so actually we're relatively closely related to other species that are still exist. But for things like the echidna or the platypus or other really odd-looking marsupials in particular, they've gone down their own evolutionary paths that they've become isolated and they don't have close relatives. So the Zoological Society of London, ZSL, decided to think a little bit more about that and say, well, is it worth trying to look after species that are more evolutionarily distinct, rather than just because they're low in numbers or whatever? So they're thinking about the bigger picture of biodiversity, of thinking what are these pathways that the individual species have gone down, that if we lose that species, we lose that whole pathway. So they have devised a system called EDGE. So it's evolutionarily distinct, globally endangered. And so they have a list of species that they consider to be highly threatened, but on the basis of these criteria. So are they evolutionarily distinct? Are they odd species? And how threatened are they globally? And this is just another way of looking at it. And it's good to see taking account of trying to capture these odd evolutionary pathways that that species have taken.